So this lecture is about IAS 37. IAS 37 deals with provisions, contingent liabilities, and contingent assets. Now, first of all, let's discuss what is the objective of this accounting standard. The objective of IAS 37 is to ensure that appropriate recognition criteria and measurement bases are applied to provisions, contingent liabilities, and contingent assets, and sufficient information is to be disclosed in the notes to the financial statement. Why? In order to enable users to understand their nature, timing, and amount. So IAS is talking about the provisions, contingent liabilities, and contingent assets. So we have to recognize, we have to measure, we have to report it in financial statement if needed. And if there is any disclosure, we have to give that disclosure as well. So first of all, let's talk about few definition. What is a provision? Normally we create a provision against a liability. So the definition says that a provision is a liability. So we create provision against liability, and the nature of provision is also a liability. So when you record a provision, it is to be recorded as a liability. So it is a liability, but it is not a liability which is a usual liability. Any liability having uncertain timing or amount or both. For example, if you have raised a loan from a bank for 5 years and the value is 100,000, you know that I have to pay it back after 5 years. So timing is certain and the amount is also certain. So you cannot create a provision against that liability. So liability provision is to be created against those liabilities having uncertainty. Uncertainty in terms of timing, that when you have to pay is not sure, or amount, that how much is to be paid. Second is, what is a liability? A liability is a present obligation and that arises as a result of the past event. And the settlement of that is result in an outflow of resources, that is the payment from the entity. So first of all, there must be a liability in order to create a provision. So present obligation as a result of past event and outflow must be there. Now, as far as contingent liability and contingent assets are concerned, we will discuss it later on. Now, once you have identified that there is a liability and there is an uncertainty, either in terms of timing or amount, then you need to recognize a provision against that liability. So what is the criteria of recognition of provision in the financial statement? An entity must recognize a provision if and only if there must be, these conditions must be satisfied. Number one, there must be a present obligation, and that obligation will be either legal obligation or constructive obligation. It means that if there is a legal obligation, we can create a provision. If there is a constructive obligation, we can also create a provision against that constructive obligation. So the present obligation, whether it's legal or constructive, that arises as a result of past event, that is called the obligating event, that has created an obligation. Number two, payment. The chances of payment is more likely than not. That is, more than 50% chances are there. And that is called probable. So the chances of payment must be probable. And third thing is that the amount can be reliably estimated, because it is an uncertain situation. So you have to estimate. And if you're not able to estimate it reliably, then you cannot create a provision. So all three conditions must be satisfied. For example, if there is a present obligation as a result of past event, payment is probable too, but amount cannot be reliably estimated. So you cannot recognize a provision, and then you have to disclose a contingent liability in some situation. So in order to recognize a provision, there must be a present obligation, payment must be probable, and amount can be reliably estimated. Now, what is legal obligation? What is constructive obligation? Let's have a look. An obligating event is an event that creates either a legal obligation or constructive obligation, and therefore results in an entity having no realistic alternative but to settle that obligation. So obligation can be a legal obligation or constructive obligation. A legal obligation arises as a result of a contract, an agreement by nature of law, by operation of law. So if you violate any contract, that will create a legal obligation. If you violate the operation of law, the law exists in the country, then there is a legal obligation. So what is exactly the constructive obligation? A constructive obligation is not a legal obligation, but if there is a constructive obligation, you have to create a provision. So how constructive obligation might arise is, it arises if past practices, one of the reason is past practices, creates a valid expectation on the part of a third party. For example, a retail store having a long-standing policy of allowing customers to return merchandise within, say, a 30-day period. Although it is not written in the contract that we will refund you within 30 days, but our past practices says that whenever a customer asks for a refund, we allow that refund. So that has created a valid expectation on the part of third party, then entity will do that. So that is creating a constructive obligation. So the source of constructive obligation is past practices, published policies, your statement, your word of mouth. But remember, this is not a legal obligation. Now, once you have identified there is a liability, there is uncertainty, and a provision need to be recognized, now you have to estimate the amount. And it's very difficult to have an amount in case of uncertainty. So IAS 37 gives you a guideline that how you can measure provision in terms of uncertainty. The amount recognized, which is an estimate as a provision, should be the best estimate of the expenditure required to settle the present obligation at the reporting date. So what is best estimate? It means the amount that an entity would rationally pay to settle the obligation at the balance sheet date, or to transfer it to a third party. For example, let's talk about a provision for warranty. We normally create a provision for warranty because if you sell a product and as a result, a warranty has been given to customer, so there is a present obligation and there is a past event, that is the sale of the product. Now, when a customer will claim a warranty, no idea how much would be the claim. So amount is uncertain, as well as timing is also uncertain. So in case of provision, we have to estimate that how much we have to pay or how much we have to record when we settle that provision. Now, when we try to measure that provision, we have to consider that the event might be of two types. One event is called provision for one-off event, and another is large population of events. So there are two situations. The provision that we are trying to create will be against a one-off event or against a large population of event. Large population of event refers to those events which incurred regularly, that is the recurring events, such as warranty is an example, customer refund is an example. And one-off event is not usual, that is restructuring provision, environmental cleanup, lawsuit, etc., etc. So what is the criteria? If you are trying to create a provision for a large population of event, then it is to be measured at a probability weighted expected value, that is EV. You have to identify the expected value of all possible outcomes. For example, if there is three outcomes, so you have to calculate summation PX, that is probability multiplied by outcome, and then sum of all the answers. And that would be a average value or expected value. But if that event is a one-off event, so probability cannot be used for a one-off event, such as restructuring or environmental cleanup. So in this way, the measurement should be based on the most likely amount rather than the average value. We have to identify the most likely amount. Most likely amount in terms of the percentage or in terms of the value. Sometimes it happens that if you are settling a provision, that amount is to be reimbursed by third party to you. So what would be the accounting treatment of that reimbursement which you will receive from the third party? So if some or all of the expenditure required to settle a provision is expected to be reimbursed by another party, the reimbursement should be recognized as a separate asset. You cannot offset your liability with that particular asset and not as a reduction of the provision. But when you will recognize as a separate asset, when and only when it is virtually certain. What is that is virtually certain means the chances are more than 95%. So if it is virtually certain that reimbursement will be received if entity settles the obligation. So if the chances of reimbursement is less than 95%, 95 or less than 95%, it means you cannot create a separate asset. And in that way, you will disclose the contingent asset rather than a asset. And the amount that you are recognizing as an asset should not exceed the amount of provision. For example, you have created a provision of 100 million. So if you are trying to create an asset against it, if it is virtually certain, it cannot increase from 100 million. It should be 100 million or less than that. It cannot be more than the amount that you have created. Normally, we make an accounting entry of provision, that is expense debit and provision as a liability credit. And if we are trying to recognize a reimbursement as an asset, then the entry would be asset debit and profit and loss account or income credit. The question is, we cannot offset these assets and liabilities, but in profit and loss account, we can offset expense with related income. So offsetting is allowed in profit and loss account, but that offsetting is not permitted against provision and asset. Now, once you have recognized a provision, entry has been recognized, that is expense debit and provision credit, as it's an estimate, so it should be remeasured at each reporting date. So review and adjust provision at each reporting date. So for example, if you have a brought forward provision, say suppose 100 million, and at year end, now it says that a provision should be 120 million, then you have to recognize increase in provision. And an increase in provision is an expense. So the entry would be expense debit by 20 million and provision credit by 20 million. Similarly, if provision is already recognized last year, 120, and now you have to recognize provision 100 million, that means there is a decrease in provision, and that decrease in provision is to be recognized as an income. So profit and loss account credit and provision debit by 20 million and profit and loss account credit by 20 million. So once you have recognized the initial adjustment of provision, at each reporting date, you have to check that whether the provision is to be increased, then it is to be recorded as an expense. Otherwise, it is to be recorded as an income. And if an outflow no longer probable, for example, you have created a provision and that provision is no longer needed, then it is to be reversed. What is the entry for reversal? Provision debit and profit and loss account credit. You have to cancel that provision. And if you have created a provision and you have to settle that provision, then the settlement would be provision debit. And whatever you are paying against that provision is credit. Now, there are a few examples of provision, such as the warranty. So in case of warranty, we recognize a provision when an obligating event occurs. And what is that obligating event? That is the sale of a product having a warranty, and probable warranty claims will be made, because we have already discussed that provision is to be recognized when there is a present obligation, payment is probable, and the amount can be reliably estimated. Similarly, in case of customer refund, recognize a provision if the entity's established policy is to give refund. That is, if there is any constructive obligation, so that constructive obligation will create a liability, and then we will recognize a provision against that liability. But remember that if there is no obligation, there will be no provision, such as in case of future operating losses. So if an entity is expecting some future operating losses and they are planning to create a provision, IS 37 do not allow this. No provision is to be recognized. Why? There is no obligation. You can avoid that losses by avoiding the activities. So provision is to be created when there is a present obligation. Provision cannot be created against future obligation or future operating losses. Similarly, if an entity will plan about major overhaul or repair, no provision is to be recognized as there is no present obligation. So the simple rule is that whenever you have to create a provision, you have to check a liability, whether it's a legal obligation or a constructive obligation. You have to see the condition of recognition of provision. That is, present obligation, payment is probable, and amount can be reliably estimated.